So I'm Dr. Vanlaningham. I really would prefer you call me by my first name, Doctor. Okay, that'd be good. No, for real, call me Mike. I don't like titles. If you don't want to call me Mike, then your worship would be fine. That'd be great. I like your worship. That's really good. So Father's Day today. A number of years ago, I had a chance to go home to Seattle. That's where I'm from. I was visiting my folks. And I saw an old friend of mine who I grew up with. And he laughed at how fat I've gotten, and I mocked his bald head, you know, it was like that. And he laughed and said, you know, Mike, we're turning into our fathers. And I laughed. I said, yeah, we kind of are. I knew his dad. He knew my dad pretty well. And a couple of years after that, I found out that Wayne Watson wrote a song entitled Turning Into Dad. And I thought I would just share the very last part of it. Watson writes, so I will treasure the high and the finer things within him, that is within his dad. And I know as he would have it, I will lay aside the bad. That I could still become, I will lay aside the bad of all the things that I could still become. I could do a whole lot worse than turning into dad. I could do a whole lot worse than turning into dad. And for most of us, I think we would probably say that. Hopefully we had parents and dads who were good guys, who took care of us. I know some of us haven't had that, and that makes Father's Day more difficult. Take your Bibles, go to Joshua chapter 24. And Joshua 24 is not really a passage about parenting or fatherhood or anything like that. But we're going to be talking about a section here that I think is very relevant for fathers and for all of us, actually. What we're looking at here is not something that is irrelevant for everybody else but a father. This relates to all of us, but we're going to especially be bouncing it off of fathers. In this text that we're going to look at, Joshua 24, Joshua exhorted the Jewish people to serve the Lord, to make serving him their highest commitment. It should be ours as well. But what does it look like to make God our highest commitment so we serve him? What does that look like? There are going to be four elements involved in making service to the Lord our highest priority that we will look at. By the way, I want to say at the very front end that my application is based on the outline, the four points in the outline that you have. And I might not talk about this a whole lot in the message, but I'm going to call attention to it right now. And those outline points are left blank, but I have them here. Choose to serve. Consider the reason you should serve him. Count the cost of serving him and confirm your commitment to him to serve him. We're going to be bouncing back and forth out of this. I just want to tell you right now that I think the application that I'm going to propose is that you would take some time, maybe in the next week, to look at these four points and to think about them, maybe even journal about them. Those of you who feel like, you know what, I need to sort of ratchet up on my commitment to serve the Lord, that you would take some time to think through these four points. Like I said, maybe journal about them and see what the Lord would have you do to grow in this area. Now, before we get started in earnest on the four different elements of what it means to make God number one so we serve him more, I want to establish sort of a prologue here in verses 1 through 13, which I'm not going to spend a lot of time on at all. I'm not really going to preach that. But it's very important for the rest of the chapter that we see what's going on there. In Joshua chapter 24, verses 1 through 13, Joshua, on behalf of the Lord, reviews with the Jewish people everything God had done involving leading them out of Egypt. It talks about the patriarchs, actually, before that, how God chose them, was going to bless them. The time in Egypt, the Exodus, how God led them through the wilderness for the 40 years of wandering, how God had enabled them to come into the land, the conquests that they had made to drive out the Canaanite and the Amorite people and others as well. So that over and over again, we see God's power. There is, in this section, in these 13 verses, 20 verbs that have God as the subject, indicating his power and his activity here on behalf of Israel. Verbs like I took, I led, I gave, I sent, I brought you, I delivered you. Things that God says over and over again. And there's a reason why that review takes place here, emphasizing God's power and God's goodness. It's because Israel needs to continue to hang on to God. They need to continue to serve him, even though the conquest is complete at this point. They needed to continue to be loyal to him. And as Joshua reviews with them, and God reviews with them through Joshua, all that he's done, it will give them greater sense of God's power. It'll give them a sense of God's kindness to them, and hopefully will motivate them to continue to have him be number one, to serve him. And so it's an incredibly important little prologue that happens here. And I think the thing that's important for us too is we have to remember all the things that God's done for us. Now, while he hasn't sent plagues upon the people that we know who are non-Christians who might be really bad, he hasn't sent plagues upon them. He hasn't led us through across dry land, through the Red Sea. He hasn't driven out Amorites and Canaanites. He hasn't had the walls of Jericho fall down for us. But guys, you already know this. God has expended enormous power and demonstrated enormous power for us. In eternity past, he decided he was going to choose us to be a member of his family and to find redemption by grace through faith in Jesus. He sent his own son to be born of a virgin. That doesn't happen every day, by the way. I want you to know that. There's power there in doing that. His own son, incarnate, does miracles and shows power. Jesus dies on the cross for our sins. He's buried. He rises from the dead on the third day. There's power in that. He ascends into heaven. He sits at the right hand of God and intercedes for us all the time. There is power, power, power all along the way that has been expended for us. And the implication is that in response to that, we need to trust him to serve him more. Even if it's really scary. Much more about this. So this is super important. Now there's one verse that we're going to spend just a little bit of time on in this first opening prologue section, and that's Joshua 24 and verse 1. So let's take a look. Joshua 24 verse 1, it says, Joshua gathered all the tribes of Israel to Shechem and summoned the elders, the heads, the judges, and the officers of Israel, and they presented themselves before God. Shechem is a really important point. I find it interesting that Joshua calls these leaders and all of Israel to him at this place. According to Genesis chapter 12, verses 5 through 8, and there's going to be a slide about this, and you can see that there's a map of Shechem, or there has been up there. Shechem was the very first place when Abram came into the promised land from Ur of the Chaldees, where God appears to him and promises him the Holy Land, the promised land. Genesis 12, verses 5 through 8 says, and Abram took Sarai, his wife, and Lot, his brother's son, and all their possessions that they had gathered, and the people that they had acquired in Haran, and they set out to go to the land of Canaan. When they came to the land of Canaan, Abram passed through the land to the place at Shechem, to the oak of Moreh. At that time, the Canaanites were in the land. Then the Lord appeared to Abram and said, to your offspring I will give this land. So he built an altar to the Lord who appeared to him. So Abram gets an encounter with God at Shechem, where God promises him he's going to give him this land. This is super important because, as we're going to see through the rest of Joshua chapter 24, God had done that. Those promises made to Abraham, God has fulfilled. And that becomes demonstrated in Joshua chapter 24. In addition, Jacob, as in Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, right? Jacob bought a piece of property there adjacent to Shechem. In Genesis 33, 18 to 20, Jacob came safely to the city of Shechem, same place, which is in the land of Canaan on his way from Paddan Aram. And he camped before the city. And from the sons of Hamor, Shechem's father, he bought for 100 pieces of money the piece of land on which he had pitched his tent. And he erected an altar and called it by a hard Hebrew name. So just So I want you to remember, just remember, that Jacob bought property next to, immediately adjacent to Shechem. And I also want you to remember that Jacob is Joseph's daddy, right? Abraham, Isaac, Jacob. And Jacob is Joseph's dad. That's going to be important, as you'll see in a little bit. All right, so here we go. We're going to talk about the four elements involved in making God number one so that we serve him better. Here's the first element. We need to choose to serve him. It has to be a deliberate and conscious choice that we make. Verse 14, Joshua now speaks, "Now therefore fear the Lord and serve him in sincerity and in faithfulness. Put away the gods that your fathers served beyond the river and in Egypt and serve the Lord." When he begins at verse 14, "Now therefore," he's looking back on everything that God said in verse 13, verses 1 through 13. All the things that the Lord had done, because the Lord had shown his power and his goodness and his graciousness to them, they could do what God had commanded them to do, and he made them successful. He helped them there. And because of that, the people that Joshua is talking to now as well can do the same thing. Now, the verb to serve, fear the Lord and serve him, that verb serve, occurs 15 times in this chapter, with serving God as the object of our service. 15 times. It's a huge theme here. And again, they could serve him. They should serve him, even if it's scary, because he has the power to help them make progress, help them to be able to succeed. It's very interesting. In Joshua chapter 1, verse 9, God said the same thing to Joshua as well as to the whole people. He says, "Have I not commanded you?" He's speaking, God speaking directly to Joshua here. "Have I not commanded you? Be strong and courageous. Do not be frightened and do not be dismayed. For the Lord your God is with you wherever you go." Right before this, God has said, "Joshua, I'm going to give this people, the Hebrew people, I'm going to give them the land. Don't be afraid. Be courageous. Don't be frightened. Go for it, dude." And you know what? He did. That's exactly what God did. He made them successful. And so he'll do the same for us. I really believe that. If we're facing sort of a scary situation that might involve serving him, if there are things in his word that he's commanded us to do, and we look at those things and we go, "Holy cow, I got to do that?" You know what? If God commands you to do it, don't you think he has the capacity to uphold you and help you and provide for you while you're doing it? He who put his own son on the cross and then raised him from the dead, do you think maybe he's got the capacity to help us when we're serving him? Then look at verse 15. Joshua says, "If it is evil," that is, if it's distasteful in your eyes to serve the Lord, "choose this day whom you will serve, whether the gods your fathers served in the region beyond the river or the gods of the Amorites in whose land you dwell. But as for me and my house, we will serve the Lord." As for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. Now, it's kind of cool. I think it would be easier to be able to say that if you're Joshua's age and you have perpetually, every step of your life, done what God wanted you to do. And that's what Joshua had done. We don't know how old he is exactly at this point, but he dies at 110 at the end of this chapter. And so he's a really old guy, but he can look back on a life where so consistently he did fear the Lord and served him as a result, even though he had reasons not to. And so now he can come along and say, "It's okay, I'm going to be an example to you guys of how we need to be." Now I just want you to know, I personally am not comfortable with coming to anybody and saying about anything, "Why don't you follow me as an example?" I would be really reluctant to do that. I think maybe one of the things I would do is I might say that as it relates to picking up donuts from Dunkin' Donuts. I can pick out a good donut from Dunkin' Donuts. You can follow my example in that. You need a good donut? Just follow my example. But there's not a whole lot of other stuff I would want to say. But Joshua could say that because he'd done it already. And he had a track record. Repeatedly in his life, he had shown he was going to serve the Lord. Some random thoughts on serving the Lord. Having us, our families, serve the Lord. The family then, if we're going to serve the Lord, becomes our number one ministry to the Lord. But I'm going to say more about that in a little bit. We teach our children about the things of the Lord, or our grandkids. More importantly, I think we need to model the Christian life. Clarence Kelland, who's a writer of children's novels, died in 1964. Once said, "My father didn't tell me how to live. He lived and let me watch him do it." I think sometimes we're better off not lecturing to our kids or our grandkids and just living, not lecturing, but living the Christian life out and letting our example just show them the way to go. Don't ever underestimate our influence as dads. Those of you who are still dads. Pastor Nick Cady of the Whitefields Community Church in Longmont, Colorado, cited a survey. And he says, the survey says that if a child is the first person in a household to become a Christian, there's a 3.5% probability everyone else in the household will also become Christians. 3.5%. If the mother is the first to become a Christian, there's a 17% probability. But if a father is the first one in a household to come to Christ, there's a 93% probability everyone else in the household would follow. What an amazing statistic. It's a little bit scary. The influence that we have as dads. It's an influence for good, or it can be an influence for ill. Robert Lewis, in his book entitled Raising a Modern Day Knight, talks about his own difficult relationship with his father. He writes, "My dad worked hard. He provided for our family materially. We were a solid middle-class family, and I do have a number of pleasant memories from my boyhood, but when my dad walked in the door at the end of a long day, his personal influence began to fade. Like in the movie The Invisible Man, my dad would shed his corporate identity at home, and as he did, he would begin to disappear altogether. He became the invisible dad. We rarely played together. In fact, I struggle to remember any time we threw the ball or wrestled together. I missed the fun side of him. He never told me, 'I love you.' I never prayed with him or talked to him about spiritual things. I never knew what he believed. His inner world was a complete mystery to me. We never sat together and talked about life or school or the future. There was no fatherly preparation for things ahead. I never heard him say, 'I'm proud of you.' I never experienced a moment when he shared with me what he thought I would be good at or what my responsibilities would be as a man. He offered no measuring sticks to my life. Dad's passivity with all of us was deafening. The lack of his direction was heartbreaking. My brothers and I were left to our own pathetic resources and guesswork for navigating ourselves through adolescence and early adulthood, and none of us did it very well." So those of us here who are dads, and I would say really for all of us, in whatever sphere of influence we enjoy, friends, family, work, whatever, we must engage with the people around us. And especially in a family setting, we need to engage with them. We cannot just be passive, and we must not be passive as it relates to spiritual things. Another random thought, we have a tendency to look at our life priorities and sort of order them from top to bottom, number one, number two, number three, number four, you know, and we oftentimes will say, well, God is number one in our life and ought to be, and he should be. And then number two is family and marriage. Number three is work. Number four, church, hobby, friends, or whatever. I just want to suggest, actually, that this is not how the ordering of our priorities should work. They, by necessity, I think, have to be more fluid. And in fact, our priorities maybe should be understood more as just a horizontal line, and we have all of our responsibilities placed upon that line. Sometimes those things are going to flex and adjust. There are going to be times where it might look like this, where family needs are going to be very high. But maybe marriage Work, church, hobbies, friends will be lower simply because our family might need more attention at a particular time. And so for a time being, those other things we don't devote as much attention to. Or it might look like this. It could be that on occasion, maybe our family priorities will be fairly low and work is going to be higher. Maybe sometimes church will be higher even than family things. Now, I just want to mention that on the last couple slides, it kind of looks like I don't have a very high regard for marriage. I am married, by the way. My wife is here. She's sitting over there. She said, "Don't you dare draw attention to me." So I'm not going to. So I just want you to know, I think marriage is critically important. I think it ranks up there just about with God. In fact, I just want you to know also that whenever God speaks to me, he sounds an awful lot like my wife. He really does. It's amazing. Here's the thing. We have to be very careful about always and only defaulting to doing family activities and paying attention to our families. We have to avoid that. There are going to be times where other things will supersede the attention that we might show to our family. And I think on those occasions, sometimes it's absolutely essential that we pay attention to those things and not our family. And I also want to say that if we are always and only defaulting to family activities against Christian commitments or church activities, that's a real problem. You have to remember, and I'm putting church activities in here, not just saying God, because I think it's very difficult to separate church from Jesus. I think to serve Jesus is almost all the time to serve in the church and for the church. Acts 9:4, Saul, who becomes Paul, is on the way to Damascus, and Jesus appears to him, blinds him, and says to him, "Saul, Saul, why are you persecuting me?" Saul wasn't persecuting Jesus, but he was persecuting Jesus' church, his body. There's a very close connection there. And if we perpetually and always and only say, "You know what, I'm not going to go to small group tonight, I'm not going to go to a prayer meeting at church, I'm not going to give money to the church, I'm not going to do all kinds of stuff for the church that the church might need, I'm not going to fulfill my Awana commitments, I'm not going to help with high five, I'm not going to do all kinds of other things because I'm going to focus on my family," that's a problem. And what it may indicate is that we have made our family an idol. And we can't do that. Take your Bibles, go to Luke chapter 14. Luke chapter 14, one verse, and then we're going to go back to Joshua 24. Luke chapter 14, verse 26. Luke 14:26, "If anyone comes to me and does not hate his own father and mother and wife and children and brothers and sisters, yes, and even his own life, he cannot be my disciple." Now, the word "hate" there is a Hebrew idiom for meaning love less. But I want you to see here in this passage that to be a faithful disciple of Jesus means to prioritize him over the family. Now, let me also make it very clear. I don't think we have to neglect our family for Jesus and church. I think almost all the time we can do both, and we should do both. There should be a balance here. But I have been in settings where I have seen Little League baseball exercise authority over a Christian family more than Jesus during the summer. I personally have a problem with that. Now, I think most of the time you should go to all the games you can go to. I think every once in a while it's appropriate for you to miss one of those games. Did I say it? Sorry, I said it. Sometimes it's appropriate to miss one of those games and to go help out with something at church. And for your kids to see you do that and to understand that for them, that's part of their role in serving the Lord within the context of the family. They should be willing to let you go do those other things. And that should happen often or not, that when it does take place and you do that, it's not some peculiar anomaly. Because you're serving the Lord as a priority. Here's the second element of what it means to make God our highest priority so that we'll serve Him more. Is we need to consider the reason for doing that. And we've already touched on this, actually, verse 16 to 18. It says, Then the people answered, "Far be it from us that we should forsake the Lord to serve other gods. For it is the Lord our God who brought us and our fathers up from the land of Egypt, out of the house of slavery, and who did those great signs in our sight, and preserved us all the way that we went, and among all the peoples whom we passed. And the Lord drove out before us all the peoples, the Amorites who lived in the land. Therefore we also will serve the Lord, for He is our God." And so again, we get sent very much the same idea that we have at the beginning of the chapter. They understand that because God has such power and He's called them to obey Him and to serve Him, that He will help them. He will protect them as they're doing that. And it's the right thing to do. Romans chapter 12, verse 1. The Apostle Paul says, "I urge you therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that you present," by the mercies of God, by all the mercies of God that Paul's laid out in Romans 1 through 11. "I urge you by the mercies of God, present yourselves as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable to God, which is your reasonable service of worship." Why do we serve God? Why do we present ourselves to Him to be used by Him as a living sacrifice? It's because of His mercies. It's because of His power that He's shown us. He will take care of us as we are laying ourselves upon His altar as a living sacrifice. He'll guard us. He'll help us. He'll protect us. He'll strengthen us. He'll use us. We need to count the cost. In verses 19 to 24, basically, what Joshua says is, if you don't do this, it's a problem. Joshua said to the people, "You're not able to serve the Lord, for He's a holy God. He's a jealous God. He will not forgive your transgressions or your sins." And I'm reading that and I'm going, say what? Here's the deal. God's a jealous God. Now, jealousy for us, super negative. But it's not for God. And His jealousy is very different from ours. According to Wayne Grudem, God's jealousy means that God continually seeks to protect His own honor. John Piper writes, "God is jealous like a powerful and merciful king who takes a peasant girl from a life of shame, forgives her, marries her, and gives her not the chores of a slave, but the privileges of a wife, a queen. His jealousy does not rise from fear or weakness like it does for us, but from a holy indignation at having His honor and power and mercy scorned by the faithlessness of a fickle spouse." See, again, I just want to suggest for the 19th time, God has done so much for us. He's shown us such kindness and exuded such power as it relates to us that for us to completely disregard Him is an enormous insult to Him. And He will not tolerate being replaced in our affections by other things or people. He won't tolerate that. And so we need to count the cost. Am I willing to follow Him? Human jealousy, by the way, is very different from that. Human jealousy, as I understand it, primarily, maybe not exclusively, but primarily, stems from fear for us. Often, jealousy is the fear of another taking my place in the affections of someone important to me. I get displaced from somebody who loves me and who is important to me. I get displaced by somebody else. But human jealousy is very different from God's. Human jealousy flows largely out of fear. We don't have that kind of power over God. But God is jealous to guard his own honor, and he will not tolerate, because it's sinful, he will not tolerate that in us. And so we need to count the cost. He goes on in verse 20, he says, if you forsake the Lord and serve foreign gods, then he will turn and do you harm and consume you after having done you good. That's what Joshua says. He gives a prophecy here. By the way, there's another prophecy in Deuteronomy chapter 4. Moses says exactly the same thing. He says, down the road in the future, Israel, someday you're going to become so idolatrous. God will judge you and remove you from the land. And when you become idolatrous, God will not simply look the other way. He won't forgive you, God says to Israel as a nation, if as a corporate whole they disregard him. They will face his punishment and his judgment. I'm happy to say that in Christ, God doesn't judge us and condemn us. But I am here to tell you for sure that if we as the children of God don't stay pretty close to him, pretty close, God might very well discipline us. And that'll be hard when it does. He does it out of love, but he will discipline us if we've decided to say, pfft, to him. Here's the last thing, last element. We need to choose to serve him. We need to consider the reason why we should. It's because he'll promise to help us. We need to count the cost, that is, we ought to do this, or else he might discipline us. And then the fourth thing, we need to confirm our commitment. So I find it so interesting, you know, Joshua says to the people, behold, verse 27, this stone shall be a witness against us. He sets up a stone that also says, you know, whenever you look at the stone, be reminded of this commitment you as Israel have made to the Lord today. And that stone is going to be a witness to you, a reminder to you, that if you make this sort of a commitment to the Lord, you need to hang on to it. And I just wonder, do we have things in our home that remind us of commitments we've made to the Lord? Do we have maybe pieces of art that we put on a wall? Do we have a bookcase with Christian books in it? That when we look at those things, we look at them and understand those are there precisely because we have made God number one and we want to serve him. There should be things like that that we have around us that remind us of these kinds of commitments. Now, there's an epilogue here that I want to look at, not part of my outline, but look at verse 29. It says, after these things, Joshua, the son of Nun, the servant of the Lord, died being 110 years old. By the way, the only other person in the Bible that I'm aware of who died at 110 is Joseph. Remember Joseph, Jacob's son? Remember Joseph? I think there's a connection. That detail being told us, there's a connection there between Joseph and Joshua. We'll see in a second. It says in verse 30, they buried him in his own inheritance at Timnath-Serah, which is in the hill country of Ephraim, north of the mountain of Gaash. Israel served the Lord all the days of Joshua and all the days of the elders who outlived Joshua and had known all the works that the Lord did for Israel. And as for the bones of Joseph, which the people of Israel brought up from Egypt, they buried them at Shechem in the piece of land that Jacob bought from the sons of Hamor, the father of Shechem, for 100 pieces of money. It became an inheritance in the descendants of Joseph. And Eleazar, the son of Aaron, died, and they buried him at Gibeah, the town of Phinehas' son, which had been given him in the hill country of Ephraim. And I read that the first time a couple weeks ago, and I thought, why are we being told about where these guys were buried? Who cares about that? Here's the thing. In ancient Near Eastern thought, you buried something on your property. You buried an individual on your property. But when you buried somebody there, that solidified your claim to that property. The fact that there's a tomb there or a burial site is a thing that says, this land really belongs to us. And so now when the Jewish people are coming at the end of the conquest period and they're starting to bury their dead in their own land, they're saying, we've got this place. God did what he promised he was going to do. He's given us this land and we're putting our dead here and he has brought it about by his power and his faithfulness. That's why we're told this. God has fulfilled all of those promises. One other thing, he talks about Joseph's bones. Who cares about Joseph's bones? Big deal, though. Go to the book of Genesis, chapter 50. Look at how the book of Genesis ends. Genesis 50. Starting at verse 24. In the book of Genesis. Genesis 50, verse 24. And Joseph said to his brothers, I'm about to die, but God will visit you and bring you up out of this land. He was in Egypt at the time. To the land that he swore to Abraham, to Isaac, and to Jacob. Then Joseph made the sons of Israel swear, saying, God will surely visit you, and you shall carry up my bones from here. So Joseph died, being 110 years old. They embalmed him, and he was put in a coffin in Egypt. And so he's in Egypt now, give or take, about 400 years. That's how long they were in Egypt. And then the Jewish people took that coffin and went with it through the 40-year wandering in the wilderness. I mean, can you imagine having to carry that thing around full of dead, rattling old bones? But here's why they did that. They take it then to Shechem, and they bury it there in the piece of property that Joseph's daddy bought, that Jacob bought. And what we have here is we have gone full circle. God promising to Abraham, Jacob believing that promise and buying property at Shechem. Joseph saying to the sons of Israel as a testimony and a reminder to them that he believed someday God would so take them out of the land of Egypt and bring them into that promised land like Abraham was told. And he so believed that he says, take my bones with you. And so they know that. They know that Joseph believes this is going to be fulfilled. And it was. It was. After almost 500 years, it was fulfilled. Listen, guys, let's serve the Lord. Sometimes it's really scary. Sometimes God asks you to give to the church. That's scary. You don't think he can provide for you? If you give like a Christian should just normally give, he'll take care of you if you do it. You know, there's five people who are needed. Still for high five. Some of you, I would be willing to bet. No, we can't bet. I would prophesy you a nickel. There are some of you sitting here going, you know, I should do that, but you're scared to death at the prospect. No, you know what? If you do it because you really believe God wants you to, he'll help you. He'll give you the power to do some great things with these kids. Serve him that way. He'll help you to do it. That's what Joshua 24 is all about. Let's pray. So, Father, help us to believe who you are. That when you ask us to do scary things, man, you asked Joshua and the people to come into a land and engage in war. How terrifying would that be? And yet you promised, I will be with you every inch of the way. And you were. Father, we have seen the insurmountability of our own sin and how by your power and your grace, your kindness, your mercies, you've overcome that in Christ. How can we not serve you in response to that? How could we possibly feel like we're going to fail miserably because you don't have the power or something to help us? Of course you do. And Father, I just think that probably, in a way, harvest has never needed all of us more than it does right now. And so I want to pray that rather than hanging back and being scared about serving or whatever, that you would help us to be bold for Jesus and to help out here and in other places for your glory and for the good of your people. Father, you'll be with us every inch of the way. In Jesus' name we pray, and all the church said, amen.